Hi, good morning, good afternoon, and good evening, everyone. I hope you are all doing well. My name is Niels. I'm on behalf of the TFS team. I would like to welcome you very much to the first virtual conference of the TFS. Before we start with the program, I would like to remind you of a few housekeeping rules. First of all, if you could please pin the program screen. Next to my window in the gallery view, you can see a box which says program. If you could hover over it with your mouse and click the three dots and then pin the program screen, this will ensure that you will get to see what's important during this conference.
Can you repeat that, Niels?
Hi, good morning, Colin. How are you doing?
Fine, thank you. Good night. Anyway, could you just repeat that instruction?
Yes. So if you go to your gallery view, which is on top of your own screen, there is a little screen called program screen. If you could hover over that program screen with your mouse, you will have find three dots.
Yep.
And it will then say pin video, and you click that, which will then basically show you the main program screen for this virtual event.
Done.
So just to give you everyone a little bit of a rundown as to what's going to happen today, we have now a 10-minute open mic community session. I'll be calling you out and asking you to introduce yourself and where you're calling from. Just to greet you, this would be our normal cocktail reception at a TFS event. This will last for about 10 minutes, and then we will have various other program items lined up. I also would like to say that the whole day today should last about 1 hour to 1.5 hours. And then we will conclude the event. So let me see who is here today. If I could see Yanis. Yanis? Hi, how are you? Yanis, can you unmute yourself? Where are you calling from? Are you able to unmute yourself, Yanis?
Yes, you I go. Just did. Hello to everyone. I'm Yanis Lenzakis from Greece. We practically have met with all of you during all the freight summits in the past. And, haven't met for too long. That is taking a toll to our mental life. Many of us can understand what I'm saying. However, I'm very keen to see all of you in the future. So let's all wait, hopefully, to meet up front very soon.
Fantastic. Thank you, Yanis. I see here Budi also. Budi, how are you? Good morning. You're calling in from where?
Hi, Niels. It's Budi from Jakarta. It's 9 p.m. here. Hello to everyone. This is Budi from Indonesia.
Nice to see you. Thanks for being here, Budi. Good morning, Gervais. How are you doing? Gervais, can you unmute yourself?
Yes, can you hear me?
Yes, can hear you loud and clear.
Yes, good. Hey, good morning to everybody, or good afternoon. I'm Jerry from the Netherlands, working for Share Logistics, and that's the first time for me at the Freight Summit.
Great, thank you. Welcome to our virtual event. I see here Robert from Quick Cargo Services. Hi, Robert, how are you?
Hi, Niels. How are you doing all? Nice to be here. It's like 3 p.m., so we are in the busiest time of all our regular year. So we are quite happy, and let's go on for this meeting.
That's right. Nice to see you. Hi, Orit. Good morning.
Hi. Not too much of your
Orit, can you? Yes.
Good morning. How are you?
Good morning, Orit. Good
to see everybody.
Nice to
I'm
see
calling
you.
From New York. Morning here, just starting up, and look forward to meeting all of you later on.
Perfect. Nice to see you, Reid. Thanks for being here. I see another familiar face, Andrew Smithhurst. How are you doing, Andrew? Good to see you.
Hi, Niels. Hi, everybody. Nice to meet all TFS friends from before. Very happy to see everybody. I'm at the moment in a very cold Leeds in the UK. It's around 2 p.m. So I hope we can have a very good conference together, and I look forward to speaking to everybody as we move along.
Perfect. Thank you, Andrew. And Tony, how are you doing, Tony? Tony, unmute yourself, please.
Hi, Niels. And hi, everybody. It's 7:35 p.m. now in Colombo, Sri Lanka. Well, it's a lovely evening out here, and I'm looking forward to catching up with all my old friends from the TFS. And of course, since it's 7:30 in the evening, I just thought I'll fix myself a glass of wine. Perfect. Cheers, everybody, and look forward to you.
Cheers, Tony. I see here Marianne. Good morning, Marianne. How are you?
Hi, good evening. So good, yes. So it's Marianne. This is, I think, the third time that I'm joining TFS from SHIPCO APAC.
Lovely to see you. Are you in Singapore?
Yeah, stuck in this tiny island.
Good, great. Good to see you. I see another familiar face, Burak. Good morning.
Hi, hello, Burak. Hello, Niels. Can you hear me?
Yes, loud and clear.
Yeah. Thanks for this opportunity to see our TFS friends, which we really missed for a long year. And I think it will be a big opportunity and very great time for each other face to face. And thanks for giving us this opportunity.
Of course. Thank you, Burak. Nice to see you. Hi, Aneta. Good morning.
Hi. Good morning, everyone. I'm from Poland, from Gdynia. It's 3 p.m. and it's dark already. And I am very happy to see all of you and can't wait to see you again in real.
Perfect. I also see here Gordon. Good morning, Gordon. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon. Hey, Gordon, you're from Cologne, Germany. It's also 3 o'clock here. It's raining, dogs and cats, but I'm happy to see all my friends again. And I have to follow Aneta and wish to see you in real as soon as possible. So nice greetings.
Perfect. Thank you, Gordon. Nice to see you. Hi, good morning, Vitek. How are you?
Good morning. Nice to see you all, guys. It's been a while. It is 9 o'clock in the morning here in Toronto, Canada. We have a beautiful snowfall. I'll send you some pictures. Great to see you, and I'm looking forward to speak to you.
Thank Great you. To see you, Vitek. I see here Alberto. Alberto de la Luz. Alberto, how are you? Can you hear me? I think Alberto cannot hear me. There you go. Hi, Alberto. Can you unmute yourself? Maybe not able to hear me. Alberto, you can speak now. I think you are unmuted. Okay, let's move on to the next one. I see Daniel. Daniel Florentino, how are you doing, buddy?
Well, hi, guys. Good evening here in the Philippines. So this is now my fourth Freight Summit. So nice to see you all.
Nice to see you, Daniel. Good morning, Claire. How are you? Oh, you unmuted. You muted and unmuted yourself.
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you now.
Hello, I'm in Shanghai. I'm Claire from Safety Group China. It's 10 o'clock. 10 p.m. here. I'm sorry, I'm wearing my pajamas and it's getting very cold now in Shanghai. It's around 5 degrees. Looking forward to see you in Shanghai soon.
Nice to see you, Claire. Thank you so much. Paolo, how are you doing?
Hi, good afternoon. Well, here it's sunshine. As you can see, the sun is in my face. I just came from the outdoor to have a nice breakfast with my daughters, and I'm really happy to see all of you and looking forward for our meeting. Thank you very much for all the arrangements, all the organization. Thank you.
Perfect. Nice to see you. I see another familiar face I haven't seen in a while, and that's Rainier. How are you doing, Rainier? Rainier, I see you're diving, one of your favorite sports. Can you please unmute yourself?
Hi, everybody. Greetings from Lima, Peru. It's 9:10 in the morning. Yeah, it's been a while since I've been here. It's very good to see you. We are coming to summer here, so it's about 25 Celsius. It's not like Shanghai getting cold. We are getting summer here, so that's good. But it's really good to see everybody. It's been a while since I've been involved in TFS, and I'm looking forward to have meetings and see my old partners. And of course, I hope all you are happy, safe in this COVID, in this pandemic, and hopefully this will succeed in early next year and we can see each other face to face. I think nothing will replace face to face meetings, but it's awfully good to see you, Niels and Christian, and I see Rob, and I see all my good friends, Colin, all friendly faces around here, I tell you. Good to see
That's
you.
Great
guys.
To see you. Yes, absolutely. Maybe time for one more. Aika, good morning. Can we see you as well, one last before we start with the program?
Good morning, everybody. It's a pleasure to see all of you here. I missed all of you. I missed to see you face to face, not virtual. But I think next year we will be all able. Looking forward.
That's right. We certainly hope so. Hope so too. Okay. All right. Well, it's a pleasure and lovely to see you all here. We will be starting now with our community updates. So we have prepared a short video for you, which we will present the TFS community updates for you right now.
On behalf of our TFS team, welcome to our very first TFS virtual conference. This has been an exceptional year for all of us. But if there's one thing that this year has shown us, then it's the realization that logistics and freight forwarding are at the forefront of providing essential transportation services to all sectors of society. We are all immensely proud and thankful for your continued contribution of your services to the global community.
Before I begin with the TFS community update for this year, I will guide you through the agenda. Today's virtual meeting will last about an hour or so with the following program. After my community updates, we will be introducing new members. We will also do the TFS digital community app launch, a live Q&A on the new normal, followed by a 5-minute break, after which Mark Miller will have his keynote presentation on logistics trends after COVID-19. And to end off the virtual conference, we will have a photo contest of the last conference with the 2019 TFS after movie and the closing cocktail. The next 2 days of our event will be dedicated for face-to-face meetings, for which you have already scheduled your meetings through our face-to-face app. Your actual meetings will be conducted over Skype. I recommend that you add your meeting partners in your Skype application so you can easily get in touch with one another. You can also schedule your call with them in Skype. What is TFS? Let me give you a recap of TFS. At its core, TFS is an open community for all freight forwarders to participate and develop business with one another. We have broken down all barriers by making it easy and simple for every freight forwarder to take part in the TFS community. Since its inception in 2008, the Freight Summit was attended by approximately 2,000 freight forwarders. Today, we recognize the need to transform TFS into an open digital forwarders community. Apart from our trusted face-to-face meetings, which we can hopefully resume later next year, we have created a digital TFS community app. The TFS community app is a powerful communication platform that includes a complete directory of all previous TFS attendees, which can be customized to create your very own and personal network agency list. Now you can seamlessly communicate with all your favorite partners through this app and make agent requests and ask for quotations. It also tracks payment habits of agents and gives you a heads up if there are any unexpected changes with your partners. All previous TFS attendees will get 18 months free access to the TFS community app. If you are new to TFS, you may still subscribe to the Digital TFS membership to gain full access to the digital community. We have prepared a video of the TFS community app in one of our next segments. We will be launching the TFS community app right after this event. With this app, we will be one of the largest open digital communities of freight forwarders worldwide. Thank you for being part of the TFS Open Forwarders community since 2008. We look forward to welcoming you to our new digital TFS Forwarders community and of course hope to see you at any of our future events.
And now we would like to take this opportunity to introduce some of our TFS friends and members that have joined our community. So please help us in welcoming our TFS friends.
Welcome to Time Shipping in Air Freight Corporation, DMC Vietnam. DMC was established in 1998 and has over 22 years experiences in handling sea and air shipments. At present, DMC is ranked as number one master consolidator in Vietnam and in the top 10 clients of management lines and airlines. Let's see a short video about our strength. We are pleased to join in TFS virtual conference. We look forward to seeing all of you soon. Thank you.
Hi everyone, this is Arish, founder of Al Amal Lines, headquartered in Amman, Jordan. Al Amal Lines works through its offices and covering all the Middle East regions such as Lebanon, Syria, Palestine, Iraq, and Gulf regions as well. And of course, we're working with other business partners and agents throughout the world. We are acting as international freight forwarder and a one-stop for all the freight forwarding needs, offering a full comprehensive transportation services, handling all kinds of cargo, such as pharma, industrial, agricultural, and communication shipments. Our unique part in our business that we can say it like added on service for us that we can offering our own storage and warehousing facility. We can offer worldwide time sensitive transportation of biological and pharmaceutical shipments. This is very quick information about the Amman Lines company, and we are looking forward to meeting all our colleagues and friends in the coming virtual face-to-face meeting, and see you all soon. Bye-bye.
Hello, fellow TFS attendees from the land down under, CT Freight. Quick introduction about our company. We have 7 locations throughout Australia in all the major ports. We have cool room and freezer facilities, as well as the ability to handle all your pharmaceutical needs. We have our special handling team for AOG shipments with 24/7 coverage Australia-wide. Our customs brokerage is all in-house, and we have dedicated teams for e-commerce handling all the major clients like Amazon and all their locations throughout Australia. Any of your needs throughout Australia, New Zealand, Fiji, or the South Pacific, let us know. We'd be more than happy to help you out. Have a great conference.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Charles Yang from Dalian Xingyang Transport Forwarder Company Limited. Our company established in 1999. We are engaging in the import and export transportation business, including all of the FCL and SL shipment and air shipment from and to China. We also supply warehouse storage services and customs brokerage, and inland trucking services. Hope we can get much more friends via the network. Thank you.
Hello to all of our future TFS partners. Sophia here with Global Logistical Connections, headquartered in LA. My colleagues and I are very excited to be joining the TFS network. We're looking forward to meeting all of you and developing long-lasting and productive relationships. Here at GLC, we pride ourselves in being able to offer our partners an all-in-one solution here in the United States. We have strategically placed locations throughout the country, over 400,000 square feet of warehouse space, in-house customs brokerage, and a full-scale nationwide e-commerce fulfillment operation. Our promise to you as our new partners is to always provide you with a streamlined experience that will allow for high quality customer service, regardless of the scale and scope of your project. On behalf of my colleagues and I, we look forward to meeting all of you and working together really soon. See you soon.
Hi, my name is Jacob Zikusoka of Interline Shipping and Logistics East Africa. We cover Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, Burundi, Congo, and South Sudan. And our range of logistics extends from air freight to project cargo to reefers. We are excited to be part of the Freight Summit this year, and very uniquely so because it's virtual. And I look forward to personally visiting each and every one of you and getting collaborations between our two companies going. Thank you very much.
Big and small, there are about 3,000 freight forwarding companies only in Mumbai. That number exceeds 10,000 when you consider the whole of India. What would you look forward while selecting an agent? Someone with IATA, direct contracts with the carriers, someone who has good pricing, maybe their own custom brokerage, network of own offices across the country, a company with years of experience, an agent with certified team to handle dangerous goods, or GDP certified to handle pharmaceuticals, a temperature control facility to store them, or someone who can offer bespoke service. But there's one company which checks all the boxes. It's called Neutral Consolidation Services, or NCS. Interestingly, I also work there. Hello friends, I'm Viraj Shetty, and me and my colleagues look forward to seeing you at the conference.
Hello everyone, my name is Mei Shang, Shanghai Branch Manager of Parisi Grand Smooth Logistics. PGS Logistics is a subsidiary of the Francesco Parisi group of companies with its head office in Bucharest, Italy. The group is engaged in freight forwarding, shipping agency service, port operating, and infrastructure management for marine and intermodal rail terminal. PGS Logistics is an Asian expert in transport and logistics solution with membership in IATA, FIATA, SAFA, and HIFA. We manage our own warehouse in all Asia and provide the third-party logistics service, FBA shipping, and cross-border e-commerce. PGS has expanded rapidly with its over 400 highly motivated professionals, and now operating in 27 service centers across Asia, is the solution for all transport and logistic needs. Thank you.
Good day all. My name is Joji Adedotun. I'm the CEO of Person International Nigeria. Person International Nigeria was incorporated in the country year 2006. In 2008, we were licensed by the Nigeria Customs Service to carry out the business of freight forwarding and logistics. Since then, we have been growing from strength to strength. We are into sea freight, air freight, and land freight. We handle cargo consolidation. We are into custom clearance. Yes, we are professionals. We are prompt in our action, and we are careless. Give us a trial and you will surely be convinced. Thank you and have a good day.
Hi, this is Budi from Skytrans Logistics Indonesia. It's been very nice to join this TFS virtual conference this year. since we cannot travel to attend our usual TFS conference during this pandemic time. Skytrans Logistics has been around for 16 years, since 2004. We are a small company with 50 people, but we offer a quick, responsive and dedicated team to our customer needs. We have a very strong background with pharmaceutical and medical equipment, among other commodities, since we are also an official logistic partner for the Indonesia Ministry of Health. And we have been very busy distributing medicine and medical supplies across Indonesia during this pandemic time. So should you need anything from to Indonesia, please let me know. Or you can send to our email address, tfs@skytrans.co.id. And last, I wish you all healthy and well during this difficult time, and hope to see you all in our next face-to-face TFS conference. Thank you.
Assalamualaikum warahmatullahi wabarakatuh. Hi, my name is Luki. I'm from PT Freight Solution Indonesia. We are a logistic provider based in Jakarta, Indonesia. Our main business is consolidation, full container, air cargo service, and project shipment also. We have a branch office of Indonesia region. We offer our best service and also best charge for all shipment. You can depend on to us to handle your company logistic service. We also believe that our customers are the most important part of our business. And we are working with client as a partner, believing that their success means our success also. We hope the above introduction will prove of interest to you. Many thanks for your kind attention. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name is Ayça Türkantos. I'm from SeaWorld Shipping, Turkey. SeaWorld Shipping is a part of a logistic group companies, which is in shipping industry since 1982. With the experience and know-how we have, we can serve our clients in logistic operations, port agency services, husbandry services, and worldwide container supply. At SeaWorld Shipping, our main concentration area is project cargo logistics, door-to-door shipments, transit cargo via Turkey to Iran, Iraq, and CIS countries, and VOCC operations, and cold chain shipments. I'm looking to receive all your requests, and also I'm looking to meet you all face to face.
Hi, greetings to everyone. My name is Raghav. I'm actually talking from Chennai, India, Team Double Logistics India Private Limited. This company was started by your founders in 2005 by Mr. Nityam Khosla and Mr. Vivek Kele. And after that, we took our IADA in 2008. And from 2008, we've been moving a lot of regular air shipments. Apart from air shipments, we do a lot of FCLs out of India and also into India. Plus, we have a strong base of LCL consolidations, where we have been getting best consolidated award in terms of LCL movements from 2010 to 2016 continuously. Other than offices in India, we also have each one office in Kenya and also in Tanzania. Then we have two offices in Bangladesh. And we are also specialized and fully equipped to offer our DAB and DDB services to your inquiries. And in case of any India movements, please think of Team Global, and we look forward to get your inquiries. And first of all, also thank you so much for TFS for organizing this virtual meeting between December 1st to December 3rd. And we look forward to meet all of you in this virtual event very soon. Thank you so much.
Hello everyone, it's our great pleasure to meet you guys here. My name is Shin and this is Jesus. We are from Unicargo Express, EDA Dynasty Worldwide Logistics Group. Our group has been in the industry over 30 years. We have office in LAX, Chicago, Dallas, New York. We which cover all the main ports of US. We can help you air, ocean, import, and export all the shipments.
What sets us apart is our great relationships with our ocean carriers and with airlines. We also have very good relationships with all of our vendors. We are here to help you solve any tough projects, and we can help you minimize costs and make more profit. Let's work together. Hay que trabajar juntos.
All right. Welcome, everybody, to the Open TFS community. Thank you very much for your introductions. I have previously mentioned in my network introduction about our new TFS community app that we will be launching soon. We have prepared a short 3-minute video to explain to you what this app can do.
What is the intranet all about? Previously, all our network information was decentralized.
Only one person per company had access to the agency list. The messaging system was a mix of different kinds of content. We didn't have a social wall for all of us to share stories with fellow members worldwide. This is how we came to the idea to combine all our network information into one app that members can use 24/7 from breakfast to bedtime. Now the agency list is in your pocket so that you can message agents in real time anywhere. And when you start shipments, follow your partners to track any changes in their profile or payment status. The app also has a social wall where you get various updates from the network and from partners from all over the world. Whenever you need an agent recommendation, we now have an exclusive section where you can post an agent request for partners to share personal contacts right here. With unlimited users per company, the entire company should be part of this app. From customer service, sales, operations, to business development.
Because a strong network is a connected community at all times.
So as mentioned earlier, we will be rolling out this app after this event, and we will be sending you your login credentials. So if you have participated at TFS before, you will have access to this global community application. And we look forward to having you all on there. It is free for all the previous TFS delegates to use. So make use of this application. It's a very powerful communication tool for everyone. All right, moving on to our next segment, we will proceed to our live Q&A session. We have invited 6 panelists to take part in our Q&A. I would like to take this opportunity to thank the panelists and introduce them. We have Andrew Kovalenko, Director of Keen and Able Logistics from Canada, who has joined us. We also have Chris War, Managing Director of Warrior Global Freight from Australia. We have Aika Tokantos, General Manager of SeaWorld from Turkey. We have Rob van Stezenel from Business Development Manager of Share Logistics from the Netherlands. And we have Gilbert Ernst, Managing Director of GE International Forwarding from Australia. Thank you very much, everyone, and good morning, good evening, wherever you may be. Sorry, I forgot, I did not introduce Jens. Did I introduce Jens? I did not introduce Jens because he was not on my notes, so I apologize for that. Jens Potschul from Shipco from Hong Kong, is that correct? Okay. I would like to proceed with asking you a couple of questions. The first question would be, how has COVID-19 impacted your business, positive or negative? Maybe we could start with Aika. Aika, how has COVID-19 impacted your business? If you could maybe share us your point of view.
Actually, first, this situation started in March. I was a little bit afraid by losing lots of shipments and having some decrease in the shipments. But actually, in fact, as we are having different business types, let's say overall it was not that bad for us because our shipment increased for air freight at the beginning for some cargo types. We lost some project shipments or we delayed some project shipments, but overall this situation was not that tragical for us in Turkey. And beside, of course, beside the business volumes, if you look the yearly volumes in total in October, November, the figures are not down also for the handled cargo volumes generally in Turkey.
Thank you. Andrew, how was the situation in Canada?
Well, for us, it actually benefited us. We had a growth in business, not necessarily on what everybody else had, a growth on hand sanitizer and facial masks, but we've targeted other lanes and other activities. We've grown our customer base. I actually opened at the beginning of COVID our Vancouver office, which John Doble, who's on this link, will be meeting with some of you. And we've had growth. I was a little bit nervous at the beginning because I thought that there would be some financial difficulties with our partners and friends throughout the world. So I was looking towards joining networks that had backing, insurance on financials. But what happened is that it ended up being better for us, growth. Canada backed us by giving us interest-free loans. I can't say, I can only imagine how it is in other countries that don't have the same government we do, but we lucked out. They backed our employees. If we had to work from home, they gave financial assistance up to 75% of our salaries paid by the government, and interest-free loans that are forgivable for partials. And it's been very good growth and very good. Unfortunately, I can't travel and see you all face-to-face. Like, I miss every single one of you, but I really appreciate the efforts that TFS has made to make this happen and give us the opportunity to see each other face-to-face at the very least until we get to meet each other face-to-face in person.
Thank you. Thank you, Andrew. Gilbert, how is the situation in Australia for you?
Well, for me, it was a mixed bag, really. It started bad at the beginning of the lockdown because we mainly, as you probably know, we mainly deal in food stuff and beverages. So with the restaurants closed, the cargo was not moving. But on the other side, we found out that we happened to pick up a few new clients here and there because the service levels from big forwarders, like, you know, the big multinational, their service level went out of the window because everyone was working from home and clients couldn't get any response in time from the their forwarder. So fortunately, we were there to pick up the pieces and they came on board. So wasn't that in the end? Now it's picking up with everything open. It's picking up again, and hopefully it's going to get bigger and better.
Nice, good. Rob, how is the situation with you in Holland?
Dreadful. How can it be? Yeah? For me, as being a local traveling around the world for 20 years in a row, and not being in Holland for longer than 4 weeks, and now got stuck for 9 months. But we have it partially under control. The situation is slowly improving, we think. But business-wise, business is good, but every booking takes you 3 times as much time as usually. There is no equipment, no space. Rates are tripling, doubling, or even 10 times as much. So it takes a lot more time. And we hope this will end soon, but I fear it's going to cost us another 6 months. Before it will return a little bit back to normal and the shipping lines get their act together or being pressed by the governments to get their act together. Left or right, something has to change with them. But we'll see. Yeah, I cannot wait to be out there again. And yes, Andrew, we know you're from Canada. But for sure, left or right, this community will help us to cope with the business demands our customers have, and that's a good thing.
Thank you. Jens, how is the situation with you in Hong Kong?
Yeah, so in Hong Kong, we suffered already last year because of the riots we had in Hong Kong. So we had a tough time already in 2019. It was in the last 3-4 months of the year. It was pretty tough for us. And then COVID came all of a sudden. And I've been in Hong Kong already for SARS. And I thought this is a fluke. It comes and it goes. And you underestimated everything. And I was actually at the time outside of Hong Kong. And I thought it's going to go away. And it got bigger and bigger and bigger. So professionally, obviously, it was impacted initially. And we have seen a double-digit drop in our volumes. But things have recovered and relatively nice, obviously, since May, June, and business is back up. It has been a roller coaster ride, I have to say, from a drop in volume now to substantial increases in volume. Markets are picking up. The Trans-Pacific, we just have seen, I think, the latest number in September and October, they have grown by over 30%. Freight rates are crazy. No equipment is out there. The situation we're seeing right now is obviously a very unique one, and it's probably a situation which is going to remain here for a little while, and especially on the ocean freight side. We talked a little bit earlier with Rob as well on the air freight side. Things are a little bit crazy, which also means there's opportunities for us, you know. So I think with all the negativity, I think there is also a little bit of hope out there that things will turn out to something positive for all of us, you know.
Absolutely, yeah. Thanks for your insight there. Chris, how are things for you?
Things are going okay at the moment. When COVID initially started, I think that was when we originally got locked down, there was a bit of a downturn business for everyone. But after a little while, it became the new normal and people started getting released into society a little bit more and things started moving. So business seemed to get back to normal around the middle of the year. There's a few other factors that have come into effect in Australia in that the borders have been closed internationally. So air freight's been very difficult because of the lack of flights coming in and out of the country. And then we've had some industrial action to the wharves, which has caused big delays in Sydney, Melbourne and Brisbane, and that's driven up rates and caused issues with lines not coming here. So it's been a bit of a multi-pronged attack on the industry. But I think there's been a few good things. I think working from home has worked well for a lot of companies, particularly the smaller businesses. Everyone has things that a lot of people have enjoyed, and it's become part of our society now in Australia that people working from home.
Indeed, I think you put the hammer on the head of the nail, as you would say. We're as small companies, I think we're much more flexible and able to adapt as compared to the much larger multinationals in that sense. So we are more nimble in that sense and able to help our clients a little better and pick up the pieces, as Gilbert would say. Moving on to our second question, I would like to ask three of you guys, what are the changes that you believe will stay on after the pandemic? As you know, we have seen a lot of changes with the plexiglass separators in supermarket cashier booths, wearing of masks all the time, and so on and so forth. Andrew, what do you think are the changes that will stay on in business and in life in general after the pandemic?
Well, I think that we're going to, all of us are going to have real issues with our flights and our long flights overseas, because I think that we're probably going to have to wear masks to a certain degree, because they're not going to be able to cover everybody with the vaccines that they're sending out. So whether or not you're been given the vaccine, if you're going to get access to it, or if you're going to travel more often, I think that'll be a long-term thing. But I think that in general, they're going to watch out for more pandemics or more diseases to be spread. They're going to be a little bit more secure, and they're going to check people's history, medical history and travel history, and see what they can monitor. But as I said earlier, when we were speaking, that what I've been seeing online is that now you're going to get the new passport, which Rob was mentioning as well, that you're going to have to be either vaccinated or you're going to be limited to your travels or entry into functions and bars and restaurants to a certain degree up until a certain level. which is concerning for me, considering I'm not 50 yet and I won't get the vaccine.
Yeah, indeed. Aika, what do you think are the changes that you believe will stay on?
I think beside everything, now the whole world see that it is possible to work from homes. So I think home study or out of office study will continue, which will lead much more digitalization. So if you are speaking with the shipping lines and etc., for example, Maersk turned to spot rate bases, and all the shipping lines are decreasing their employees. So everything will continue in this way, and I think we will find this in the future very rare to visit customers, maybe because everything will be online, and because everybody is now seeing that this is possible, and no need for spending 2-3 hours on the traffic for seeing a client. So even though I'm not a fan for this, even though I like personal contact, I think this will stay in this way.
That's a good point, Aika. I agree with you on that one. There's probably a lot of future trips that we will think twice. Is it really necessary that I have to take this trip?
And don't cancel the conventions, okay? This is not the conventions.
of course. But I mean, even for myself, if we're not traveling for conventions, like you say, maybe we're visiting clients, but then we were thinking, do I really have to visit that particular client? Can I not do that maybe over video conference first before I go visit him? So a lot of these things will pop up. Gilbert, how about for you? What do you believe are the changes that will stay on and will remain after the pandemic?
Well, I was thinking, like Aisha said, the online system, like digitalization of the thing. We've proven now with COVID that if you've got a cloud-based system, you can actually work from home. So and it worked very well for us. It was like no change at all. I think that will stay. And I think socially, the mask will stay in Australia. And then vaccination, really. Qantas already is saying that no vaccine, no flight. So if we want to travel shortly, I think we will have to vaccinate. And other things is, I still believe, even though we're going to go more towards online services, that certain client will still like that face-to-face meeting. So
absolutely, yeah, it's not something.
Especially the old school, maybe the new up and coming, the younger people will not, but the old school clients will still want to see you, will still want to talk to you and go and have a drink with them. So.
Yeah, but for sure. Totally agree with you there.
But mostly the change, the big change that will stay is the online services and working from home. I think a lot of companies, especially small companies, will go that way now because it's been proven with COVID that it works. So I think that's
right. Thank you. Yes. Now, if I could ask you to take out your crystal ball, Jens, when do you believe the economy in your country will recover to back to pre-pandemic levels?
Well, I live in Hong Kong, so maybe you asked the wrong person. So I think we recover faster than others. China's obviously doing well as our neighbor and our big brother here. But I think until the world is, or Asia is completely back to normal, it's a good question. What is normal, you know? So I think the world will, not only, we talked earlier about it as well, there's a reset button we probably all press personally, but also I think business might change. And I think cargo flows will change, the way people do purchasing. I'm not sure if I can answer your question, but 2021 is definitely a transition year, and life will not be the same probably afterwards, you know. I definitely see that interregional trades are gonna grow rather than the long haul business probably. Sourcing will change. It will take definitely some time, but uncertainty is here to stay, you know,
yeah.
And it will take some time.
For sure. Well, it's just interesting to see because different countries have adopted different measures with regards to recovery measures and government support. So some countries are on the mend and recovering already. And we hear from China that they're in full steam recovery mode and even catching up and sort of being a driver of the world economy. So it's interesting to see how different approaches countries are taking. Rob, when do you believe the economy in your country will recover?
Well, I don't have a crystal ball. I think it will take 2-3 years because I think trading will be pretty quickly. It continues at this moment already. But what we will be facing is that all the billions the government is spending to keep businesses alive, we as private people will need to pay those back. So we will pay the bill at the end through our tax situation. So we are going to be harmed for, I think, 20, 30 years by paying higher taxes to recover from the billions the government did spend, which I'm very positive about. It was the only right decision they did. I'm not criticizing them, but we will feel that a lot. With regards to business, logistics is a people's business. We can't do without traveling. We can't do without meeting around the world. And I think even more in the Asian countries, just on video conferencing, it's not going to work. You need to have physical contact there. You need to be able to dine and wine with them to win their trust, and it doesn't work purely on video conferencing. So yes, a vaccine, I will be waiting. Even if there is a row 10 kilometers outside, I'll be waiting to get one of the first vaccines possible. And I'll hope to be on the first plane ever, which I can head out, no matter what it will be.
Hopefully the airlines are not bankrupt by then, you know, all of them.
Let us know when you have your first appointment, Rob. We'd like to know how you feel after the vaccine so we can all hop on the same bandwagon as you do.
Rest I assured, shake. I'll share it to everybody.
I want to shake your third hand.
That's good.
Chris, last question goes to you. What is the crystal ball telling you right now? When will Australia recover or go back into full recovery mode, if that's even possible?
I think it'll be some time, Nils. Australia did very well with controlling COVID, but the reason they did well is that we had the opportunity to close the borders fairly early, so we could contain the spread of the virus pretty quickly. But when they did that, they locked down and spent a lot of money on unemployed people returning their jobs and creating jobs, and that tap's still turned on at the moment. And it's costing the government billions, and I think it's due to come off early next year. So when they turn the tap off, the money, the free money they're giving to people off, then people are going to start losing their jobs again. People are going to start not being able to get jobs easily. Unemployment benefits are going to drop. And those things slow things down. We've got an added thing at the moment where there's issues with our markets, with China in particular, and the core businesses Australia's had for some time. Looks like changing, and they're talking about us needing to find new markets. And we were hoping that there'd be after a bust, there's always a bit of a boom, but I can't see where that's going to come from in the near future if we've got issues with trade. So, I mean, hopefully, I'd like to think by the middle of next year, we'd be back on track, but I fear it could be a little bit longer than that.
Indeed. Well, thank you for your insight there. Well, that concludes the panel discussion. Thank you, everyone, for your contributions, your insights, and your opinions. It's been great to see you, and it's been great to hear from you. Moving on to our next quick segment, we have, as you can see at some of the delegates in this virtual meeting, we have a virtual background, which we create and which we can then impose behind our profile. If you would like to have a virtual background created, we can do that for you. We can put your logo, we can do the design for you, and we can then send you the picture so you can have your own virtual background with your own company logo for any of your future virtual meetings that you may have. So let us know in case you need that. We'll move on with a quick 5-minute break. Please don't go away. We have Mark Miller with his keynote presentation. It's about 10 minutes, and then we'll have a little bit of a fun section with a photo contest and the video, the TFS video of Macau last year. And that would then conclude our day for today. So please stay on, don't leave, get a coffee or beer or orange juice or whatever it is that you're having, and I'll see you in 5 minutes. All right, welcome back. It's always great to see pictures of previous events. It just makes you realize how much you miss attending conferences and networking with other people. I have seen, it's the first time that I have seen these photos, so it brings back great memories. Moving on to our next program section is Mark Miller. We would like to introduce his keynote speech video, and his topic is COVID-19 impact on global supply chains. Mark Miller is an international renowned keynote speaker and a respected authority on supply chain and logistics, and the author of the widely acclaimed book, Global Supply Chain Ecosystems.
Hello, this is Mark Miller, author of the book, Global Supply Chain Ecosystems. I am pleased to be able to share with you my thoughts and insights about the COVID-19 impact on global supply chains. We are now on the cusp of a thrilling new era for supply chain. This coronavirus crisis has vividly exposed the profound interdependencies in today's global supply chain ecosystems and powerfully demonstrated the intrinsic risks in our complex, connected, volatile world. In this presentation, I will explore the supply chain ramifications of COVID-19, which is already proving to be a super accelerator of some pre-existing megatrends, including globalization shifts, digital disruption, and the e-commerce frenzy. The next normal will be characterized by uncertainty, but what is certain is that this virus will have significant supply chain implications, both over the short term 12 to 18 months, but also over the subsequent 2 to 3 year medium term, such that supply chain 2025 will be substantially different on multiple dimensions. The initial impact of COVID-19 was supply-side gridlock, as mainland China went into a coronavirus-induced hibernation just after the extended Chinese New Year holidays. This resulted in global shortages of components and products, making it powerfully and painfully apparent just how global supply chains have become inextricably dependent upon China. COVID then embarked on its own globalization journey, spreading fear and uncertainty around the world as healthcare systems became overwhelmed. Widespread lockdowns ensued with shops and businesses closing. High street retail came to an abrupt halt, triggering the most dramatic collapse in demand. The exceptions, of course, being medical supplies and equipment, which experienced an unprecedented surge in demand. As consumers became unable or unwilling to venture out of their homes, shopping for groceries and household essentials moved online en masse, turbocharging the e-commerce frenzy and generating unparalleled volume growth in small packages for home deliveries. Then, just as China started to reopen their economy and factories were getting back to work, production orders were getting cancelled due to excess inventories and lack of demand. And so global supply chains ground to a halt. As these extraordinary supply chain shocks reverberated around the world, companies are being forced to urgently reevaluate their sourcing strategies, business models, and distribution channels. This inevitably resurfaced discussions about the relocation of offshore production. Let's recap. Nearshoring is the relocation of production activities closer to the market where the products are going to be consumed. Onshoring, also known as reshoring, is one step further, whereby production is moved back into the country where the goods are going to be consumed. These are not new topics. Recall other huge supply chain shocks such as the Fukushima earthquake, the Iceland volcano, and the Thailand floods, they all triggered animated nearshoring discussions, championing the need to relocate production closer to the final consumption markets. However, what typically happens is that enthusiasm for change tends to dissipate as things soon get back to normal and companies realize the actual enormity of truly reconfiguring their supply chains. But this time is different. This time, I believe, nearshoring will become more than just talk for a number of reasons. Firstly, this COVID crisis is much more severe in impact and global in reach than previous supply chain shocks. The consequences from a supply chain perspective will be much deeper, much wider, much more long-lasting. Secondly, this COVID predicament is intertwined with massive geopolitical tensions between the world's superpowers, tensions which have already triggered some companies to relocate the production of their US-destined products in order to avoid the US tariffs on China-sourced imports. And thirdly, with the continuing growth in emerging markets and the increase in intra-regional trade, globalization had already become somewhat stalled. And so with the increasing polarization between East and West, coupled with lingering frustrations about differences in business practices, I believe it's inevitable there will be some decoupling, resulting in changes to global trade flows. And so COVID becomes the catalyst that actually stimulates companies into taking real action on reshoring and nearshoring initiatives, which will reduce dependencies and diversify risks, but will obviously result in shorter supply chains. However, relocating your supply chain is much easier said than done. This is not for the faint-hearted. Today's supply chains have been built up and fine-tuned and developed over a number of years, if not decades. They cannot just be readily untangled, packed up, and moved elsewhere. This is a serious undertaking, whether nearshoring or reshoring. It's a project that's likely to be measured in years, not weeks or months. And whilst COVID is the catalyst for companies to take action, COVID-related restrictions will inhibit the process of reconfiguring the supply chain by nature of travel-related limitations and, of course, the restriction on in-person exchanges. Accelerating the process, on the other hand, will be government incentives. The United States, with much fanfare, has announced grants and subsidies and tax relief for American companies that relocate their manufacturing back into the United States of America and create American jobs. It's not just America. Canada, Korea, some European countries have all announced initiatives to encourage the relocation of manufacturing. Japan, for example, has allocated a $2.2 billion fund to help Japanese companies repatriate their manufacturing back into Japan and create local jobs. Now, of course, in these first world economies, there's a concern about the high cost of labor. And this is where I believe we'll see automation come readily into play. Robotics and automation are substantially lower cost now than they were 20 or 30 years ago when we started the offshoring globalization journey. And readily available, economically viable automation solutions will ease the process of reshoring manufacturing back into developed market economies. Now, for nearshoring, the key beneficiaries need to obviously be in close proximity to the final consumption market and have lower cost platforms. So the key contenders for the United States market, for example, would be Mexico as the leading contender, leveraging the North American Free Trade Agreement as well. for European markets, Eastern European countries such as Poland, Turkey, Hungary would be leading contenders as nearshoring platforms. So nearshoring will reduce reliance on Asia in general and China specifically, and we'll see the supply chains being typically much more regionally focused and therefore shorter. They could be configured as made in Latin America for America or made in Eastern Europe for Europe. However, this will in no way result in a mass exodus of manufacturing outside of China, but we will see some diversification across the Asia region. Several reasons for this. First of all, we are now firmly in the Asian century. One third of global GDP is in Asia. We are home to 1.8 billion people in the consuming class. And by the year 2030, Asia will represent two thirds of the world's middle class. So made in Asia for Asia will remain a very viable supply chain strategy for generations to come. And this will enable companies to capitalize on the huge potential across Asia's emerging economies. At the same time, more and more companies will also be diligently exploring their China Plus options, looking for additional locations around Asia for sourcing and production of products and components where there is abundant labor that is lower cost than the China labor has become. Different sectors will have a different mobility, if you like. Garments, footwear, sports goods, furniture, their supply chains are relatively mobile or movable, certainly compared to much more complex products and supply chains like high-tech electronics, household goods, and automobiles. So the leading contenders around the Asia region, they vary by industry segment. But Vietnam, Indonesia, India, Bangladesh, Cambodia, these are all contenders for post-pandemic divergence of production activities that can leverage their low-cost labor markets. However, none of these alternatives can match the huge extent of China's resources. China remains the clear leader in both scale and scope, leveraging its massive infrastructure investments over the last 20 years and its huge workforce. And for that very reason, many supply chains will remain in China, or at least remain China-centric. And that includes all the multinational companies who are selling into China's enormous domestic market, whether they are targeting the consumer or the industrial segments. Such companies will retain within China all their manufacturing, sourcing, and assembly activities for goods destined for sale in the domestic China market in the supply chain strategy that is now known as In China for China. So in summary, the consequences of COVID-19 will result in a step change for global trade as we know it, spelling the end of 30 years of globalization. Post-pandemic, the next normal will see some radical reconfiguration of global supply chains, adopting a much more regional and localized approach. Evolving through to year 2025, we can expect to see widespread deployment of shorter supply chains that increase control, increase responsiveness, and increase resilience, whilst also reducing lead times, reducing transport costs, and reducing emissions, and helping to mitigate risk. And so in times of such great uncertainty, it is best to be prepared. Companies should be planning for the worst, hoping for the best, and always expect the unexpected.
All right, thank you very much, Mark, and thank you everyone for your attention to this. Moving on to a lighter section of our program, we have prepared a photo contest. We have asked you to submit your photos of your last TFS events that you might have attended, and submit to us your best or most fun photo. So this contest basically the winner of the contest will receive a free sunset cocktail prize. So we will be playing back a slideshow of 10 photos. We will be playing back that slideshow 2 times. And afterwards, there will be a Zoom pop-up poll. And if you could please click your selection in that pop-up poll, and we will then make the announcement of the winner after the video. Please take a look at the following fun slideshows. So could we please have the poll now ready for people to select their favorite photo? All right, if you could please click your winner in here, it would be great, so that we can establish the winner of the photo contest. We will be tallying the votes as we're playing back the official after movie of TFS, which is the after movie of the last TFS event in Macau. Can we play that back right now? Take me back. All right, do we have a winner from the photo contest? All right, awesome, congratulations. And who submitted this photo actually? Do we have the person who submitted this photo? Is it Onda?
I sent it.
Sorry?
I think it was me.
Oh, it was you, Marianne?
Yeah.
All right. Well, congratulations.
Andre told me that he needs to. Well, maybe some other members also sent the same. I'm not sure though.
Well, I do. I think we have seen a couple versions of this photo. But if you are the one who submitted this particular photo, then you would be the winner, and you would be getting the Sunset Cocktail sponsorship for the next TFS event, which okay. we hopefully will be able to do next October in Bangkok.
Thank you. Andre All told right. me that he's going to buy insurance after that photo.
You have to share it with me. I took it.
Yeah, that's right.
Okay, awesome. Well, congratulations to you guys. Thank you very much. I think this concludes our TFS virtual conference. Thank you very much, everyone, for staying up late, for waking up early, for making yourselves available, and for taking an hour and a half of your valuable time to be spending with us together. Thank you very much, everybody, and also the whole team behind, without whom this wouldn't have been possible, of course. Our organizing team and our staff who have been very hardworking over the last couple of months to put everything together, even though this was a relatively quick 1.5 hours. You can imagine that taking videos and looking for photos and all of that, putting all of that together takes a lot of work and effort and time, of course. But we've been very grateful, nevertheless, to all of you for all your support that you have given and shown us. So thank you again. And this concludes everything for today. And I wish you successful face-to-face meetings over the next couple of days. We will have a short survey also coming up, I believe, after this, if you could help us in filling out your survey to tell us what you think about this virtual event that we've put together, that would be great. So thank you very much, everyone, and see you soon. Hopefully next year, my fingers are crossed, and I can't wait to have a real face-to-face interaction with all of you. Thank you so much, everyone.